Thank you very much, Praveen, for your kind introduction. And very happy and healthy good evening, dear my friends and fellow colleagues. So, indeed, I am so glad to be with you this evening as a part of this webinar speaker program. So, today's topic is Do Carbs Matter? The Carbohydrates Matter? And the clinical importance in guiding treatment choice for insulin initiation. That is the topic today. And we have a small agenda, like it has been divided into three parts. And the first part will be like dietary pattern of Indian people with diabetes and the role played by the carbohydrates. And the second part will be the high carbohydrate intake, which is linked to the complications of diabetes. And that includes the mortality and prior to that the morbidity, and the last one being the aiming for total glycemic control through insulins. So now I move on to the content. The principal components of the diet, as the National Institute of Nutrition, the NIN, which is in Tarnaka, Hyderabad, is the central institute which gives the guidelines and the recommendations for the dietary, the recommended dietary allowance, that is RDA, or the recommendations related to the diet in different settings, and the Indian consensus guidelines for healthy eating recommends that a balanced diet should provide approximately like the whole diet should comprise like 50 to 60% of total calories from carbohydrates. It's preferably in the form of complex carbohydrates, not the simple carbohydrates, and 10 to 15% of the calories must be from proteins, and preferably it should be from vegetable origin, the plant origin proteins, and preferably not from the red meat origin. Let it be fish or let it be chicken, it's okay, but not red meat. And 20 to 30% of the calories from visible and invisible fats, that is the total intake of the fats, we should get the 10% of soluble fiber, not more than 10% of soluble saturated fatty acids, and 90% must be in the form of polyunsaturated fatty acids, PUFA, or the monounsaturated fatty acids, MUFA, as per the recommendations of the American Diabetes Association. And what do Indians have in their diet? This is a very valid point. And high carbohydrate diet is a common Indian reality, like BMJ open results from a dietary survey in an Indian T2DM population, that is called a starch study done by Shashank Joshi and Anil Bansali and others. And it shows, the slide clearly shows that the content of carbohydrates and proteins and the fats taken by different parts of the country, like you take the southern part and the northern part and the east and then the western part and the central part of the India. They should start with our south. Usually we take like 64% will be the carbohydrates, and 14% is the proteins we take, and 22% is the fats we take. And when it goes to north, they take around 63% of carbohydrates, 15% of proteins, and 22% of fats. And when it comes to the western part of the India, it is like 61% of the carbohydrates they consume, and they consume 14% of proteins and 25% of the fats. And coming to the eastern part, they consume 65% of carbohydrates and 16% of proteins and 19% of the fats. And coming to the central part of India, they consume 67% of carbohydrates and 14% of the proteins, and the 19% is from the fats. See, on an average, what we see is the carbohydrate content is at least the maximum being the 67 and the minimum being 61. So, in a nutshell, we can just come to a conclusion that the carbohydrate intake in all parts of the India is more or less somewhere around some 60 to 70%. So, 61 to 70% of energy intake in Indians is through carbohydrates present in the diet, which is very very hazardous to the health, because the increased carbohydrate contents is related to the development of prediabetes or the diabetes, or it's related to the cardiovascular mortality. So the refined grain consumption and the metabolic syndrome in urban Asian Indians, this is a study done by the Radhika and et al. And this study was done in Asian Indians who habitually consume high carbohydrate, and the higher intake of refined grains was associated with insulin resistance and metabolic syndrome. And you can clearly see this, the y-axis is the metabolic syndrome. It's adjusted for odds ratio and 95% of the confidence interval. CI is nothing but confidence interval. And the x-axis shows the intake of the quartiles of the refined grain intake. As it goes on, there is increase in the incidence of the metabolic syndrome. So finally, refining of the grains, the conclusion is that destroys the structure of the kernel and removes the dietary fiber, which is very important for our day-to-day functions in preventing several diseases like disorders like the diabetes or hypertension, or to control the dyslipidemia, or to prevent the cardiovascular complications like myocardial infarction, or the stroke, or the obesity, or the constipation, or the large bowel cancer, especially the colorectal cancer, especially, right? And the dietary carbohydrate profile in the urban Indians and the associated diabetes risk. You can see this cartoon actually. So it is the content of the carbohydrates and the glycemic multiple parameters are there. The carbohydrates grams consumed in a day, and the glycemic index, and the glycemic load, and the dietary fiber. These are all adjusted the odds ratio for diabetes actually, and you can see very clearly that is the lowest in the first one and the highest in the last one. And so total dietary carbohydrate and the glycemic load and the glycemic index were associated with increased risk of type 2 diabetes mellitus, and dietary fiber intake was inversely associated with diabetes. That is, if you take more of dietary fiber, whether it is soluble or insoluble fiber, that is going to decrease the incidence of diabetes, or in frank diabetes, it is going to control the diabetes without any dysglycemia. Lack of fiber food and high carbohydrate food, they predispose the prediabetes as well as the metabolic syndrome, as well as the diabetes and the cardiovascular mortality and dysglycemia in the patient suffering from diabetes. So the low carbohydrate diet helps improve glycemic control in T2DM beyond its weight loss benefits. Yeah, this is very important take home message. The low carbohydrate diet helps, like it should be all the time. An ideal diet should comprise of 40% should be carbohydrates, 30% must be the fats, and the another 30% must be the proteins. If you increase the proteins and decrease the carbohydrates, that improves the glycemic control in T2DM beyond its weight loss benefits. It has got a lot of advantages, like the lowering dietary carbohydrate intake demonstrated the benefits on the glycemic control beyond its weight loss effects. It also has led to lowered anti-glycemic medication requirement. If the patient is on 2-3 oral anti-diabetic agents, you can reduce to 2 if it is 3. And if the patient is on high dose of insulin also, by just changing the proportions of the carbohydrates and proteins, by reducing the intake of carbohydrates and reducing the and increasing the intake of proteins, that leads to a drastic fall in the daily doses of requirements. And here you can see that they categorized into this, the low carbohydrate is an one arm, and the low fat diet plus Arlistat is a weight slimming agent that acts by inhibiting the enzyme lipase, which results in the non-absorption of the fat from the intestines. So, and the third group is the low carbohydrate diet plus the low fat diet plus Orlistat. You can see the difference. The clinical measures. This is body mass index per kilogram per meter square, and the body weight, and the percentage of change in the body weight, and the parameters, the laboratory parameters taken here are the hemoglobin A1C, that is HbA1C, the glycosylated hemoglobin, and the fasting glucose, and percentage of achieving, and 50% decrease in the MES. MES is nothing but medication effect score, and it is divided into that the three parameters, and finally you got a wonderful results, like lowering the dietary carbohydrate intake demonstrates the benefits on the glycemic control beyond its weight reduction effects. It also led to the lowered anti-glycemic medication requirement. So, unlike high carbohydrate diet, high protein diet can aid in remission of pre-diabetes in obese adults. This is very important take home message. That's what I have been telling from the beginning. So, you need to reduce the carbohydrate diet and increase the protein, which results in the remission of pre-diabetes. Pre-diabetes is very important. Either the impaired fasting glucose or the impaired glucose tolerance, either one of these are put together is called pre-diabetes. And pre-diabetes is very important in the sense that it has got the equal amounts of the cardiovascular events as we see in diabetes. So pre-diabetes, if we can pick the patients in the stage of pre-diabetes, we can prevent the complications of pre-diabetes similar to that of the diabetes. So, this study has reported a 100% remission of pre-diabetes with a high protein diet, and this is an article published in British Medical Journal, Open Diabetes Care. So, the remission of pre-diabetes to normal glucose tolerance in obese adults with high protein versus high carbohydrate, it's an RCT. High protein diet, that's what I've been telling, 30% of the protein, 30% of the fat, and 40% of the carbohydrates. And high carbohydrate is 15% protein, 30% fat, and 55% of carbohydrate, and the subjects were considered to have remission of their pre-diabetes if at 6 months they had a fasting glucose of less than 100 milligram per deciliter, that is absolutely normal, and a 2-hour glucose level of less than 140, that is absolutely normal during a single OGTT, because the IGT can be diagnosed only if it is done if OGTT is done with 75 grams of glucose, then only you'll be able to establish the diagnosis of pre-diabetes. Whereas fasting doesn't need anything. So less than 100 fasting and the OGTT of less than 140 is considered very normal. And coming to the second part, the high carbohydrate and linked to complications of diabetes and mortality. And 10-year risk coronary artery disease risk increases with high carbohydrate. This is an original article, and the association of dietary fat and carbohydrate consumption and predicted 10-year risk for developing coronary artery disease in a general Japanese population. So you can see the diet they are given, the carbohydrate which is low and intermediate and high, that is as low as 49.7, that is around roughly around 50% of carbohydrates is low, and intermediate is around 56%, and the high carbohydrate content like 62.3, and that has shown the positive association of dietary carbohydrates with the predicted 10-year coronary artery disease risk. So the high carbohydrate to cereal fiber ratio was associated with an increased risk for incident coronary heart disease. So here the variables are the total fiber. The studies they have looked into is one is HPFS, that is heart professionals health professionals follow up studies, and second is NHS, that is nurses health study, and the cereal fiber is given and studied, and the carbohydrate total fiber, it is studied in both the studies, like and the carbohydrate and cereal fiber, this is studied in the both HPFS as well as NHS study, and the study participants were grouped into quintiles of the energy adjusted carbohydrate exposure variables, with reference group presenting the lowest quintile, and the quality of carbohydrate matters. Certainly, yes, the dietary cereal fiber appears to be an important component of the carbohydrate quality. And low carbohydrate diet helps improve kidney function in a significantly better manner. You can see the parameters here. The diet which has got like the GI is glycemic index, the reducing the glycemic index of the foods and reducing the percentage of carbs and reducing both the glycemic index as well as the percentage of carbs. The glycemic index is again divided into the mild, moderate and high. Anything of GI less than 55 is called mild glycemic index foods, and anything in between 55 to 70 it is categorized as moderate, the foods to be taken in moderation, and anything beyond GI of 70, above 70, it is called high glycemic index. They are the forbidden foods for the patients suffering from diabetes. So you can see the clear difference. These are the markers of this particular the kidney function. The reduced cystatin C, that is very very sensitive test. Cystatin C, generally we don't do it, but okay, it is much adapted in the Western scenario. That is, you can clearly see the reduced cystatin C, and you can clearly see in the second bar the reduced beta 2 macroglobulin. And third thing we find is the increased eGFR. All the time you should calculate the eGFR. You cannot go by the simple serum creatinine. So creatinine should go down, and inversely estimated glomerular filtration it goes up. The increased eGFR is a positive finding in kidney disease. So you can clearly see from this diagrams that low carbohydrate diet helps improve the kidney function in a significantly better manner. And high carbohydrate intake is associated with higher risk of total mortality. The association of fats and carbohydrates intake with cardiovascular disease and mortality in 18 countries from 5 continents, that is pure study, it's a prospective cohort study, and you can see the diagrams. And the rise in the risk in total mortality and the major cardiovascular disease appeared when energy intake from carbohydrate exceeded 70% of the energy. That is the lower confidence initial and above the hazard ratio of 1. And more is the carbohydrate diet, more so is the associated risk of mortality. You can clearly see the mortality, that's what I said, the mortality especially from the cardiovascular origin goes up, shoots up as the carbohydrate intake is more. It is like it is proportionately the cardiovascular mortality increases, and the conclusion is 28% higher mortality in those subset who deprived 77% of total energy from carbs compared to those who derived only 46% of total energy from carbs, and 61-70% energy intake in Indians is through carbohydrates present in the diet, which we have seen in the first slide itself. The entire south, north and the east and west and the central part of India dietary cultures, and whereas this energy intake through carbohydrates is 39-47% in Western population. So we consume lot of carbohydrates, and that is the reason why we have this alpha glucosidase inhibitors, either the acarbose are the voglibose, are the megalitol. They are used much in our country only, and some of the Asian countries, and never in the never find in the international treatment algorithms for type 2 diabetes. You don't find the alpha glucosidase inhibitors because their carbohydrate content is very very low when compared to the Indian scenario. And then coming to the last part of the talk, and aiming for total glycemic control through insulins. So the RSSDI consensus recommendations for insulin initiation in people with type 2 DM. So as newer and effective OADs have been made available, that is the DPP-4 inhibitors and the SGLT2 inhibitors and the GLP-1 receptor agonists, it is recommended to consider insulin in cases where the patient fails to achieve or maintain HbA1c levels after the administration of 3 OADs, out of which one should be a newer agent. Or if the patient is intolerant to any of the individual agent or the combination of the agents. And though there are several oral new agents available, their glucose lowering potentials are relatively less when compared to the with insulin, and hence insulin should never be delayed if HbA1c remains high. Even the American Diabetes Association in its recommendations, it always says if you find an A1c of around 9 or above 9, it is high time you have to start the insulin inevitably with the existing OADs or without the OADs, you have to start insulin. That is the latest recommendations and the guidelines. So in an Indian person with type 2 diabetes mellitus who eats 3 times a day, more than 50% of the day is spent in postprandial phase. You can see this bar diagram. The navy blue is the postprandial state, and the light blue is the post-absorptive state, and the gray is the fasting stage. So you can see the breakfast here, and when it comes to lunch, when it comes to dinner, and this post-absorptive stage is, and from 12 o'clock to early morning 4 o'clock, and from 5 to 6 it becomes the fasting state. And treatment strategy should address the both meal related and fasting hyperglycemia for optimal HbA1c control, because HbA1c is not only dependent on postprandial but also on the fasting. So everything put together, that gives the HbA1c. Like in Asians, postprandial glucose should be controlled at all levels of HbA1c. The Asian picture, you can see still the fasting in the gray one, and the post lunch is in the blue one. You can see this, okay. The HbA1c quintiles on the x-axis, and then the contribution, and then the y-axis. And you can see the diagrams. See, all the time you find a high postprandial glucose levels, and in the to start with, and almost after that, higher contribution of PPC at lower A1C levels, similar to the Caucasian data from the Monier et al. And the significant contribution from PPC even at higher HbA1c levels in Asians, unlike the Caucasian data from Manier et al. This is a comparative study. The Caucasians are compared with the Asians. Despite the similar fasting plasma glucose reduction with basal insulin, fewer Asian patients achieve target A1C as compared to the non-Asians. See, there is a significant difference between the Asians and the non-Asians. You can see the gray one is the non-Asian bar, and the Asians are the blue one. And the patients treated with type 2 DM treated with insulin glargine U100. And the patient level pooled analysis of 16 randomized control trials and assessing glycemic responses in Asian and non-Asian people with T2DM initiating with insulin glargine U100, and the conclusion is prandial component needs to be addressed in Asians, and there is no significant difference in the dose requirement. And aiming for total control, the role of insulin and its co-formulations. And here you can see the basal insulin, is basically that controls the fasting plasma glucose, and it cannot effectively counter the postprandial plasma glucose. And both of them are interrelated, and both contribute towards the HbA1c, the glycosylated hemoglobin. As discussed earlier, it depends on both fasting and the postprandial state. The increased PPG and FPG drive that increase the HbA1c. And next slide, we are going to see this is the aiming for total control, the role of insulin coformulation when compared to that basal insulin. When it is combined with a basal insulin, the ultra long acting basal insulin, insulin degludec with insulin aspart put together, that's a basal plus insulin that effectively targets the fasting plasma glucose as well as the postprandial plasma glucose. So eventually it is going to reduce the HbA1c level. Increased PPG and FPC drive increase in HbA1c. The recent meta-analysis found that PPG has got a stronger correlation with HbA1c than fasting plasma glucose. Insulin coformulation provides the total control of PPG and FPC, and in turn an effective HbA1c control. And this is the IDEC, as we can see. This is the degludec, the 70%, and the insulin aspart. This is the rapid acting analog when combined, the 30%, and the basal insulin, long acting basal insulin, ultra long acting basal insulin, degludec 70%. It is IDECASP. The basal and bolus components of the insulin coformulation retain their individual characters, actually, because this degludec is present in the form of diexamers, whereas the insulin aspart is present in the hexamers, so that when it is injected subcutaneously, the insulin degludec gets absorbed very slow, and the dissociation is slow, so the absorption is also slow. It stays in the body for more than 24 hours. And whereas this is a rapid dissociation and rapid absorption, this are regular acting analog the insulin aspart, rapidly dissociates and gets absorbed very fast, so that it can control the postprandial excursions. So that is the reason why it is to be given with a large meal of the day, the basal plus. If the lunch is the large meal, the patient is advised to take with the lunch, just prior 5 minutes prior to the lunch. If the dinner is the large meal, that can be taken with before dinner. And if the breakfast is a large meal, can be given accordingly. And insulin degludec and aspart can be easily timed with major meals of the day for insulin initiation or even for intensification. The insulin degludec components of insulin IDEC ASP reaches a steady state within 2-3 days. As you can see, it's given once a day here, it's given twice a day, that is BID. And the dose remains same. Here it is once a day, it is 0.6 units per kilogram body weight. And here it is twice a day, it is the same 0.3 divided into two times. The steady state, the glucose lowering effect from the basal insulin degludec component is similar regardless of whether insulin degludec aspart is administered once or twice daily, as long as the total daily dose of IDEC ASP is unchanged. The bolus component provides the postprandial coverage, and the basal component provides a fasting coverage with no stacking. And to summarize the things, the Indian reality, people with diabetes have high carbohydrate diet resulting in high postprandial plasma glucose levels. Higher prevalence of diabetes and metabolic syndrome is associated with a higher intake of carbohydrates, and the carbohydrate diet is directly related to with the higher risk of coronary artery disease and the renal dysfunction, that is diabetic kidney disease, and is related to mortality finally. And the lowering carbohydrate content can help improve the glycemic control. However, patient adherence to lifestyle modification is poor. When initiating the insulin therapy, the choice of regimen should directly help tackle the postprandial glucose levels after high carbohydrate diet in a convenient manner like insulin co-formulation, that is insulin degludec and aspart, that is a basal plus insulin. And thanks all for the patient listening. Thank you so much.
Sir, indeed, thank you so much for sharing your views, thoughts and insights based on the vast clinical experience you have brought the world of diabetes, the treatment of diabetes, I would say. Thank you very much, sir. You touched on the critical parameters, especially on this topic, like diabetes, a dietary pattern of different parts of India, and the linkage between carbohydrate diet complications and mortality of diabetes, and of course, a suggested approach to get total control and treatment of diabetes. So these are the important topics you touched on, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, most and, welcome, Praveen. It's my privilege to be with you this evening.
Yeah, indeed, it's our, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Now we move on to the second presentation for this evening. Before that, let me introduce the second speaker now. I'll just take